going to start by asking you a question that I want you to answer only in your mind. And once I ask you, once you know the question, you will know why you should answer only in your mind. Right? And I promise that it will move on in a few seconds. It will be uncomfortable. I just want you to think for a few seconds. The question is, what is the worst thing you've done? What's the worst sin you've ever committed? I don't want you to talk about it, I just want you to think. If you're a believer, if the devil is bringing guilt and shame, that sin is already taken on the cross, so we're not trying to guilt and shame you. And if you are not a believer, I hope this leads you to the cross, leads you, because only Jesus can take care of this sin. For some of you, as you're thinking what the worst sin or worst thing you have done in your mind, what's in your mind, for some of you, it could be some kind of crime that nobody knows about, or you've been convicted in the past, and you feel, even as a Christian, like, man, that's a sting in my past. For many people that I've counseled, it's some kind of sexual sin. When you were younger, or maybe kind of either sexual or emotional or some kind of fear in your own heart. For some, it's something that you did when you were angry. Okay, you would not have done otherwise, but in that moment of anger, you did something or you said something, and you look back and say, man, that was terrible, and it was bad sin. For some of you, it has to do with what you put in your body, either through a bottle or through a needle. Now that you have one of those sin in your mind, the worst thing you have committed, let me suggest to you that there's a sin that is far worse that you have committed, most probably committed than that, what you're thinking right now. Some of you are like, what a great day to come to church. Okay. Whatever sin that you're thinking right now in your mind, chances are very likely that there's a sin that we're going to talk about today that you have committed that's far worse than any other sin that you thought in your own mind. And chances are you did not think of this sin, or you don't feel guilty about this sin. And that is the sin of unbelief. The sin of unbelief. Now, the sin of unbelief is not no belief. Okay, some of you may not be a Christian here. You know, you've not heard the gospel. You've not been exposed to Christians or to the gospel. It doesn't mean no belief. It also doesn't mean you have doubts. It doesn't mean that unbelief is not being ignorant. Some of you just don't know. In the Bible, the sin of unbelief is willfully refusing to believe despite knowing the truth. So it's a willful act. You've seen the evidence. You know the truth. You're familiar with the gospel. You're familiar with the stories of the gospel. You know everything, but you choose not to believe. Jesus said in Matthew 11, Jesus warned some cities that the judgment for some of these cities, the cities are Capernaum, Chorazin, and Bethsaida, it will be far worse because they knew, they saw the mighty work of God, they heard the gospel, they saw and the evidence, yet they failed to repent and believe. My brothers and sisters, if I ask you what it was the first sin of Adam and Eve, that we would say it was disobedience. You know, they ate the fruit that God told them not to. But even before that, actually the first sin that they committed was unbelief. God told them, instead of believing what God said, when devil came and questioned, hey, do you really think God really said that? Do you really think God is really cares for you? Do you think God has your best interest? Instead of believing what God said, and to believe and put their faith in God, Adam and Eve chose to disbelieve, believing the deception of the devil. So that's what we are going to look at today. Last week, if you remember, what did we talk about? We talked about faith. Okay, we talked about faith is basically what? Faith is believing that God is who he says he is, and that he will do what he has said he will do. If you were not here, I would encourage you to go and listen to online. So today is just the opposite. Okay. After Mark talked about faith from Jairus' daughter and that lady with the bleeding issue, he's going to give us a contrast today of what unbelief looks like. Unbelief is just opposite of a life of faith. So let's look at our passage, verse 1. Okay, Mark chapter 6, verse 1. He went away from there and came to his hometown, Nazareth, and his disciples followed him. So Jesus here, just to give you a little background, Jesus is here preparing the disciples for what's coming next. As we will see when we go to verse 7, in verse 7, Jesus is going to send out his 12 disciples to on their first mission trip on their own. Okay? He's going to send two by two to go proclaim, to do the works of that Jesus did. But before he sends them, he wants them to prepare, give them a realistic expectation of what ministry looks like. Because chances are, so far, the disciples have a very unrealistic ministry of idea of what ministry looks like. Because so far, they've been celebrities. Jesus has been a celebrity. They've been celebrated because they are followers of Jesus. Jesus has been on a roll. You know, he's healed the paralytic, the leper, cast out demons, you know, quieted the storm, and everything great. People are amazed, and everybody's following him. Huge crowd. So the disciples are thinking, wow, this ministry stuff is great. This is exciting. This is fun. This is a piece of cake. You know, we will go out and in Jesus' name heal people, take care of people, and everybody would follow us. Everybody would believe. And this will be great. The danger that they were facing is of unrealistic expectations. Because ministry does not always look like, and Jesus knows that. They had a great success in ministry so far, but things would be different going forward. My brothers and sisters, I know a lot of pastors, a lot of ministry, you know, when they're young, they're like, or when they first start in the ministry, they're very excited about ministry. Yes, I'm going to change the world. I'm going to do all these things. But after a while, the reality hits of discouragement, of rejection, of things not going as they expected. So a lot of them drop out. Okay, just having this unrealistic expectation. Because in ministry, there are a lot of times it's filled with discouragement, disappointments, and hardship. So Jesus, who cares them, this is a training ground for them. Jesus has been training them for 3.5 years, and he's going to train them more. He said, he's thinking, I need to give them a realistic expectation of what ministry looks like. So Jesus is probably thinking, I know a perfect way to give them a realistic understanding of ministry. I'm going to take them to my hometown. I don't know where your hometown is, but for most people, going back to their family that they grew up, going back to their hometown is very humbling experience. You know why? Because the whole world might be really impressed with you and accomplished, but when you go back to your home, you're still that little Jimmy. You're still that little Dave, right? You're like, you think, oh, people will be thinking, oh, I'm such a great person. But say, somebody's like, oh, you think you're a great pastor or a great person right now? I changed your stinky diapers. Okay, how many of you had? You think you're great? You go by thinking, oh, I know when you were doing this and that. So if you know somebody who is too impressed with themselves and you want to humble them, just visit them, their family with them. Okay, that's a humbling experience. So exactly this is what's going to happen. So Jesus is going to actually take them to their hometown. Verse 2, to give them a reality check of what ministry looks like. And on the Sabbath, verse 2, on the Sabbath he began to teach in the synagogue in his own hometown that he grew up in. And he probably went to the synagogue. And many who had heard him were astonished, saying, where did this man get these things? What is the wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands? Okay, these are great questions. But see what comes next. Verse 3. Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James, Joseph, and Judas, and Simon? Okay. We know them. We know these guys. At this time, you know, James and the other brothers were not even believers in Jesus. They were just ordinary guys. They were nobodies. I said, hey, we know them, and they're not that impressive. And are not his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. And Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and among his relatives and his own household. So Jesus is in Nazareth, and it says the people there are astonished. Now, this is not, they saw the works of Jesus, they saw the teaching of Jesus, they see his wisdom, they even recognize it. Man, how come this guy has so much wisdom, so much knowledge, so much power? I mean, he went to school here. And we don't have good schools here. How did he get all these things? So they are asking the right questions, but this astonishment is not like, wow. This astonishment is like, huh? It doesn't make sense. He's the ordinary guy. I mean, I remember changing his diaper. I remember when he was going around, you know, making these mud homes. I remember when he was playing with sand. I remember. They are so focused on what they know, their familiarity with Jesus. It's like, they're kind of astonished, not in a good way. It's like, we know his brothers. We know his family. These are just ordinary family. And they go, isn't he Mary's son? This was meant as a contempt, because usually people will address, should I say, isn't he Joseph's son? Because people who were back in the day would say, hey, is this the father's name was the one that you were recognized. So most probably, they were going, hey, do you remember? Like 30-some years ago, there was this lady. Remember that Lady Mary? She was a young teenager, and she became pregnant. And she just said, oh, the Holy Spirit came and made me pregnant. She made up that story. Remember that girl? That's this guy, this Jesus, it's her son. And the rumors were going around that Jesus was an illegitimate child. They're like, he's the Messiah? I mean, I know he was a good carpenter. His dad taught him some good skills. He used to come in our homes and fix stuff for us. He used to build, you know, furniture for us. But he's a Messiah? I mean, and Jesus was not a unique name. You know, now, especially in the American culture, most of the Jesus is usually, we don't name our son Jesus. But back in the day, it was just a common name. It's like you go to a Home Depot and say, hey, that guy in aisle 3, Larry, he's the Messiah. People are like, what? We know him. He's no Messiah. He's a carpenter. He's just an ordinary man. He may be a nice boy, or he was a good man when he was here, but no Messiah. But they're so there. As they saw the works of Jesus, they saw the teaching of Jesus, but because of their familiarity with him, they reject him. And so Jesus says this common saying, it was a common saying back in those days, a prophet is not without honor except in his hometown. Okay. We have a similar saying today. What is that? Familiarity breeds contempt. And in this case, my brothers and sisters, familiarity breeds unbelief. The people of Nazareth, my brothers and sisters, I believe this story is here, is to serve as a warning for each one of us for the sin of unbelief. It's possible to be so familiar with Jesus, so familiar with Jesus that you don't even recognize who he is, that you do not even believe who he is. You're so familiar. You know all the stories. This might be true for some of us, especially those of us who grew up in a Christian family. You've heard about Jesus. You know the stories. You've heard the gospel several times. But you're not impressed by Jesus. It's like, I know those things. What's new? I've heard it even in my Sunday school. I've heard that all day. Give me something new. You're not impressed by Jesus. My brothers and sisters, this is a very dangerous place to be. Some of you, even you confess Jesus. You even know your Bible. But you may know your Bible well, but do you really know the God of the Bible? It's possible to be highly literate in the scripture, which is a good thing, and yet not know the God of the Bible himself. If some of us are honest, you will describe your relationship with Jesus as more familiar with him. You know him. You know about him. You know the scriptures. You will describe your relationship as more familiarity with Jesus rather than having a real relationship, real faith in him. Now, you still appreciate good sermon. You still like singing. Nothing of that changed. You may still come to church once in a while. But you're underwhelmed by Jesus. You're not impressed by Jesus. The stories of the cross is a good story, but you've heard it. Christmas is a great celebration. Family Easter is a great American celebration, but it's more cultural. You don't have a problem with Jesus. These people did not have a problem with Jesus. They didn't think he was a bad guy. They knew he was a good boy. They didn't have a problem with the humanity of Jesus. And most people today, they like Jesus. They like the humanity of Jesus. They don't have a problem with that. Is when it comes to the divinity of Jesus, they're like, huh? That doesn't make sense. He was an ordinary man. He might be a good guy. He might be a wise guy. But he was God? Or he's Messiah in this case? No. Some of you don't have a problem with Jesus. You don't have a problem in hearing a sermon. You don't have a problem with anything. But you're not passionate about Jesus either. Your relationship, my brothers and sisters, it's more familiarity with Jesus rather than having a real relationship with Jesus. My brothers and sisters, as parents, for those of you who are parents, you need to be very careful with this. One of the harmful things that we can do to our children is to expose them to Christianity, to a moral Christianity, to outside conformity to Christianity. So they come to church, you're happy about it, they read the scripture, and they know the stories of scripture, and you're great, and these are good things. But do they really know Jesus? You know, people tell, you hear stories about 80% dropping out of the, you know, when they go to college. Why is that? And people are like, what happened? For some of us, you know, it might be a route for them just to kind of explore. But a lot of them, it was a familiarity with Jesus. They're like, I know him. I know him really well. I know the stories. But they did not have genuine faith. My brothers and sisters, when it comes to our kids, that's why it's really important if you're parents, and this applies to leaders and all of us, you don't teach them the gospel. Don't just try to conform them to external rules and regulations, you know, which is important. You should have a rules and regulations, but it's important that you not only teach them, but you model what genuine faith, a faith with vitality, looks like. Because if they don't see it, they need to see that faith matters to you, that you're not just going through the motion, that it matters to you. When it comes to difficult decisions of your life, it matters. Now, I'm not saying that if your kids are not walking with God, you know, rebelling against God, this is the only reason. The kids rebelled for several different reasons. After all, Jesus could not get his own family to believe in him. But this, we should be mindful. And for young people here, don't think just because you go to Awana, you know, you're serving or anything. It's very easy to have a borrowed faith, so to say, not a real faith, where you are familiar with Jesus, but you don't have a relationship with him. My brothers and sisters, a genuine relationship with Jesus means that you desire Jesus, that you have a desire to please him, that there's a passion in your heart for him. It means that you not only find Jesus useful, but beautiful. We talked about that before. Because a lot of us, we find Jesus useful. Okay, we even like coming to church. We even like, you know, knowing and learning something. But we are more religious. A true faith desires to worship God. A true faith, a genuine faith, wants to see your life changed. A true faith, when you have true faith in your heart, you cannot live with sin. Okay, on that particular sin, when God convicts you, when there's sin in your life, God convicts you and you want to change. Now, this doesn't mean that there's always, you know, your faith is going up and up. There may be ups and downs in your life. But my brothers and sisters, the thing is, we need to make sure that our faith is real and genuine and not just familiarity with Jesus. And that's why unbelief is found in very places that we don't think should be there. We don't think unbelief should be in there, people who actually grew up in this church all their life. But you can know so much about God and yet not have genuine faith. You see Jesus as important, you know, thing, and you even think he's helpful, but you do not follow him. Your life is not lived for him. And that's a dangerous place to be in. And because of their unbelief, verse 5 says, and he could not do mighty work there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them, and he marveled because of their unbelief. This was a bad day for Jesus. Only a few people got healed today. And he said, because of their unbelief, Jesus could not do mighty works there. In his own hometown. People ask me all the time, why do we see greater work of God, mighty work of God, of people in outside countries, say in China or in India or in South America and a lot of South, you know, Africa and other places, and not so much in America or in Western nations? I think there could be many different reasons, but a part of the reason I think is this. Because even in American culture, Christianity has, for a lot of us, is just a cultural thing. Your parents were Christians, you're a Christian, and you go to church, and you do Easter things and Christmas things, but it's more cultural. But you don't have that passion. It's a real faith that wants to follow God, that desires God, and finds him not just helpful, but valuable. And it says Jesus marveled at their unbelief. There's only two places in the scripture, in the Gospels, where he says Jesus marveled. One here is at their unbelief in their own hometown. They saw the mighty work of God. They saw the wisdom of Jesus. They saw all the evidence that should tell them, hey, he is who he says he is. And yet seeing all that, it's like, no. You don't want to follow him. We don't think he's the Messiah. The other place that Jesus marveled is the faith of centurion. You won't expect a faith in a centurion, but Jesus marvels at this. So my brother and sister, what gets your attention of Jesus is either your faith or your unbelief. Jesus marvels. Now after this brief hometown training, Jesus is going to send them out for their real first mission trip. Okay, verse 7. And he called the 12 and began to send them two by two and gave them authority over unclean spirits. So Jesus sent them as a messenger. Now it's same thing for us. If you're a believer, you are a sent person. We are messengers of Christ. Now these disciples had a unique place in history, a unique place in the kingdom of God. They were apostles. We don't have the same power, same authority as they wrote the scriptures. So not in the same way, but we are also our sent people. And it says he sent them two by two. It is for accountability, for support, for credibility. Ministry should never be done alone. And even in the early church, you say when they send out, they sent Paul and Barnabas out. They two by two for accountability. And it's a good practice to have. And Jesus gave them authority over unclean spirits. He goes like, it's not your authority. I do not want you to go authority. My authority is not my authority. It's the authority based on the word of God as I teach. Okay? So even as you go and proclaim, Jesus saying, you're not going with your own authority. Your authority comes from me. Power is not in you. I'm going to empower you. So my brothers, the same thing. As you go preach the gospel, as you serve, in whatever way you want to glorify God, or God has called you to glorify God, remember, the Spirit of God is in you and with you to empower you. And that's not, if God uses you, it's not your own power, not your own ability. Is the Spirit of God that is at work in you. Verse 8, he charged them to take nothing for their journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and to put on two tunics. He tells them, take nothing with you. Okay? Just take a change of clothes, two clothes, and put on your sandals and your staff. That's it. And he said, I want you to trust that I will provide for you. Now, does that mean if God calls you as a missionary or evangelist, you should not fundraise, you should not take anything, you should just take a change of clothes, you should just put on your shoes and go and trust God? I know there are people who actually teach that. Okay, we are supposed to follow this. A lady a while ago, I think I was at a birthday party or something, not from our church, somewhere else, and she said, hey, do you get paid from your church? I said, yeah, thankfully I do. You know, I don't have to work somewhere else. The church pays it. He's like, no, we don't pay our pastor. I was like, what? Good thing I'm not working in your church. And she's like, the reason we don't pay our pastor is because we want our pastors to live by faith. I say, where does the Bible say that? I say, the Bible I know says the righteous shall live by faith. It doesn't say only pastors shall live by faith, right? And it says, actually, Paul gives very clear instruction that, hey, if the elders, you know, preach and teach, the pastor teach and teach, the church should meet their financial needs. Okay, it's a very, very clear thing from the scripture. And so I hope that she changed her mind. And part of the reason, I think, it was just this. They're like, hey, if there's evangelists, I know there's some people who say, hey, if you're a missionary, you shouldn't fundraise, you shouldn't do this, you should just trust God and just go out. I actually personally know people like that. But my reason is, the reason I'm saying this is because you cannot take one verse and make a whole theology out of it. Okay? That's how you get wrong teaching. So if you just see this, yeah, it does make sense. If you're going preaching the gospel, take nothing with you and just go out. But here the reason Jesus asked them not to take anything with them, because on the first journey, he really wanted them to learn that as they start on a ministry, you can really trust me, that I will provide for you, I will take care of you. But this is not a general pattern for missionaries or for anybody. And the reason is, Jesus later in Luke chapter 22, starting in verse 35, and this is when he's sending them out towards the end of his ministry, he tells them, when I sent you out with no money bag or knapsack or sandals, did you lack anything? They said nothing. Jesus is like, back in the day, when I called you and sent you on a first mission trip, I told you not to take anything. Did I provide for you? Did you lack anything? They say, no, you were faithful. Everything you provided just in the right time and right place. We learned to trust you during that time. But he said, but now let the one who has money bag take it, and likewise a knapsack, and let the one who has no sword sell his cloak and buy one. So Jesus said, okay, back in the day, I told you and everything went well, but now that you do trust me, I want you to take your money back, take your wallet, take your suitcase, take your food that you need, okay? Take all your things that you would need for your ministry, and if you don't have a sword, take a sword with you. It's a controversial topic for someone, but that's what Jesus said. Okay, take a sword with you, because on the way you will meet bandits. You know, you need to scare them off. Okay, I'm with you, but you still need to have your sword with you. Okay, and you may need it for hunting, for whatever. If you don't have a sword, get a sword, sell your clothes, and get one. Okay? He doesn't go, hey, just go out, and don't worry, I'm with you. Trusting God, Brian Brunson, doesn't mean that you don't take common sense thing. Like, if you know you need something for a journey, I know a lot of people, hey, you know, I just trust God, I don't believe in going to the doctors or taking medication or doing all those things. Okay, I would just go by faith. This is what means to live by faith. No, that's a wrong teaching. To live by faith means you trust God, but also use the provision that God gives you. Amen? Verse 10. And he said to them, whenever you enter a house, stay there until you depart from there. And if any place will not receive you and they will not listen to you, when you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that people should repent, and they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and healed. So Jesus said, I want you to go to your town. I want you to go to somebody, knock on somebody's house. And because back in the day, there was no hotels, you know, there were inns. They said people were expected to open their homes, and people would expect open their homes to even strangers. And I want you to go in their town and say, hey, we are here to share about Jesus. We want to stay with you. And please let us know. And if they open and welcome you in, say peace, may God bless them. Okay, if they say no, get out of here. No, we don't have space, we don't care about Jesus. He said, shake your dust off and walk out of there. And go to the next town, go to the next family, go to the next person. Don't keep insisting on there. Move on. My dad, when he started the ministry, he applied this verse literally. I don't recommend that, but you can. But God still uses that. When my parents were, my dad was only 24 and my mom was only 21. And they were from this South India, this place called Kerala. They were in a Bible college. And somebody came in. There's a place called Bihar that there's no mission work there. And, we would encourage some of you to go. And So as they were listening to this chapel speaker, whoever come, they put, God put in their hearts to go there. Okay. But the only problem was they had no money. Okay. They were not literally trying to obey him. They just didn't have any money. Okay. And they were like, God, what are you going to do? We want to go there, but we don't have money. One of their relatives said that, hey, we'll buy you a train ticket. And it was expensive. It was a three-day train ride to get to this place called Bihar. And so thankfully, they said, like, hey, we don't have money. We just have a suitcase, and, you know, we'll take some of our clothes. And with just one suitcase, they got on a train and trusting God that God will provide. They've never been to that place. They don't speak the local language, you know. And my dad knew a little bit. And they got on the train, and it's like they have no money to stay in a hotel. And we are here after a three-day train ride, and they don't have any money to go back. So my dad is like, he asked some people around in the train station and say, hey, is there any Christian or is there any church that you guys know of? And somebody said, yeah. It's like a few minutes, 10, 15 minutes walk. You go in this direction and there's a church there. So both my mom and dad, they walked there and they finally saw the church and they were so excited. So they went and knocked at the parsonage, and the pastor there, the older gentleman, opened the door. And my dad says, hey, I'm Pastor Eapen. I've come from Kerala, from far away. This is my wife. And then we recently got married, and we are here because we want to share the gospel in Bihar. The guy looks at them and say, we don't want anybody. We don't need anybody here to share the gospel. And my dad said, you know, we've been here, and we don't have a place. Is there a way we can stay in the church? They're like, no. And it was getting late and it was kind of dark, and that place is not known to be a safe place. So my dad said, hey, can we at least stay inside in the church campus, inside? They're like, no, we don't need people. You go back to where you came from. It was old Anglican church, old Anglican priest. And my mom was waiting. My dad's like, I do not know what to do. And he told me, he literally went and then shook his fist. And he turned around. I don't know what happened. Either the guy got scared, he knew this verse probably, or got convicted. He's like, hey, come back. You know, you have your young wife with you. It's not a safe place. I don't know why you young kids do stuff like this, right? And there's an outhouse there, okay? For the church, it was actually a storage. You guys can live there, okay? You can stay there till you find your own place. My brothers and sisters, that's how my parents started the ministry in that place. And today we have a big church right in the center of the city. And I think about that, you know, that God can even use that. God used that for my parents' ministry. I don't recommend it. I say, Dad, how did you guys do that? Okay, go on a three-day journey, not only in language and everything, but God had given them the faith. I don't recommend if you go share the gospel and shake the feet and turn around. Okay, my dad was pretty radical. And I think what Jesus is saying here basically is when you go preach the gospel, you will encounter people who would believe you, who would welcome you. But you will also encounter people who won't believe. And if people don't believe, okay, don't get discouraged, don't get disappointed, move on to the next person, move on to the next family, move on to the next town. This teaches us, my brothers and sisters, a very important truth, a message, that we as proclaimers of God's word, of the gospel, we don't have the responsibility, it's not our responsibility to change people's mind. Okay? Some of us, we take that responsibility on ourselves. We just need to trust the power of God's word. We need to persuasively share the gospel. We need to be, but if people don't believe, people did not believe Jesus. His own family did not believe. They believed later. And you would have, because one of the things I see, a lot of us are scared or get discouraged in sharing the gospel because you feel like, well, I shared the gospel, nothing happened. This person, I don't know what they would think about me. Jesus says that when you go out, and that's what he was doing with them. He was sending them out, and this is for us. As you go share the gospel with your family, with your friends, you will face rejection. And that rejection is normal. Not everybody will believe you. Not everybody will welcome you. There will be people who would make fun of you, like they did even of Jesus. when you share the testimony of how God works something in your life, other people say, wow! They're like, they might roll out like, oh, that was a coincidence. Then you're like, ah, oh, why did I share? So this will be happened. But my brothers and sisters, our job is to be faithful in proclaiming the gospel. Faithfully in sharing what God has put in us. Faithfully sharing what Jesus has done. So my brothers and sisters, as we close, let me give you two challenges. First is evaluate your faith. The Bible tells us to make sure our calling is real. For some of us, my brothers and sisters, you're more familiar with Jesus, if you're really honest, and not really have a personal relationship with Jesus. And this is, my brothers and sisters, a deception the devil wants you to live in. Some of you, you grew up in church, but if you're honest in your own heart, you struggle with unbelief. You know the truth, you've seen the truth, you've seen God at work, but you always, you don't take the step of faith. You even come to church, you do all the things, but there's no, you're not radically following Christ. You have not given your life to Christ. My brothers and sisters, my prayer is, as we go into a time of prayer, for you to open your heart and say, God, help my unbelief. Break my hardened heart. I don't want to be just familiar with you, but I want to have a personal relationship with you. Give me a desire to worship you. Give me a desire to help you to know you. And for even some of you who are Christians, you have a genuine faith, but you have taken God for granted. You're too familiar with him. Cross is just, gospel is just something that happened in the past, but it doesn't drive your life right now. For you to come before God and say, God, help you to really believe that you are who you say you are and that you will do what you have said you will do. Second, my brothers and sisters, let's be faithful proclaimers of the gospel. We've all been sent out, every single one of us. This is not just for pastors and missionaries, evangelists. We all call to Great Commission is for everyone. You need to go where God has called you, where God has placed you, at your work, in your home, among your friends, wherever that God has placed you. Know this, that you are a sent person. And say, God, I want to be your representative. I want to go with your word, with your authority, with your power. And my brother and sister, when you do face rejection, don't get discouraged. And not just when you're sharing the gospel, any ministry area, when you fail, there will be disappointments. There will be times that you're like, God, I can't do this anymore. And during this time, know